Welcome to the UGC lecture series. In this lecture, we will be talking about the relational data model. As we have already discussed in the last class, on the last lecture, we were speaking about how data model is very important for the design and the working of a good database management system. So, in this lecture, we will be talking about what is the history of relational modeling, and then we will try to understand what is meant by a relational model, and then we will understand the various components of a relational model. This is what we will be doing in this lecture. So, first of all, the question arises, why relational data model came into the picture? So, it is almost impossible to store a huge amount of data without proper management, that is understood. I mean, that is a reason for having a database management system itself, and then you have to manage and store data, and there are many methods and models that have been developed. But the relational data model has proved over the last so many years up to even now that it is one among the best data management models that are available. So, there are basically the relational model, this is an important data model which is including the object relational extensions, and this is present in almost all commercial database management system, it uses the relational model. And you also have a slightly semi-structured data model, again based little bit on relational only, and these are the including the XML and the related standards. So, again we have just touched upon this in the last lesson, but what is the data model? It is a notation for describing data or information, and it basically consists of three parts: the structure of the data, arrays and structures or the objects, the actual entities, the operations on the data, what are the queries, the operations that retrieve information, what are the modifications, operations that change the database, and the constraints on the data, what are the limitations or certain conditions that you put on how the data should be. Okay. So, that is the basic basic components of a data model. So, a relational database model is based on the concept of what is called as a relation. The strength of the relational approach, what is its strength, is that the database management system, the approach to the database management system comes from a formal foundation provided by the theory of relations. So, it comes from a formal foundation. So, this is its strength. We will see the strength later on when we talk about how designing is done. So, we review the essential of the formal relational model. In practice, standard model, it is and that is what SQL is based on. There are several important differences between the actual formal model and the practical model, but we will be looking at both the models later on. So, before we go further, as we have already discussed in the last lesson, this is introduced by Ted Codd in 1970. Ted Codd was an IBM researcher. During that time, the models that were prevalent were network model and hierarchical model, and he laid the foundation for the basic database theory that is present today, and many database concepts and products are based on this relational model. So, a relation is a mathematical concept based on the idea of sets, the set theory that we studied in maths, it is based on the set theory, and the model was first proposed, as already said, by this, and the paper in which he proposed this is called as relational model for large shared data banks in the communications of the ACM in June 1970. So, it is this one paper of Codd that is now the basis of almost all commercial database systems even 30 years later. So, it uses relations as data structures and then algebra for specifying the queries, and it did not tell anything about the mechanism for updates or constraints. And then follow up papers after that introduced new language based on first order logic, showed it was equivalent to algebra, and introduced integrity constraints. So, initial paper did not have that. So, these papers, all these papers put together caused a major revolution in the field of database management itself, and it earned Dr. Codd, Ted Codd, the coveted ACM Turing Award. So, now let us look at why we should study relational model. So, this is because it is extremely useful and simple, it is a very simple concept to understand. It is a single data modeling concept, and it consists of relations, and this relation is a 2D concept, two dimensional concept. But even though it is so simple, it allows clean yet powerful manipulation languages. So, and it is the most widely used model. Vendors include IBM, Informix, Microsoft Access, Oracle, Sybase. All these commercial vendors use the relational model, and the recent competitor like object oriented model is the object oriented model, like objects so store, versand, ontos and so on. So the relation, now let's come to the actual relational model. The relational model is based on tables, okay, it's based on tables. The name for the table is called a relation, we'll come to that later. And the structure portion resembles an array structs in C, and the column headers are field names, and each row the values of struct in the array. From now on we won't talk about these terms, it's just to get you a feel of what it means. So a relational model is most widely used data model for commercial data processing, simple and easy to maintain. Basically it is based on a collection of tables or relations. So users of the database can create tables, insert new table or modify existing tables. There are several languages for relational database querying like SQL, Oracle. All these languages are based on facilities for creating new table, inserting new tables and modifying existing tables. So for example, a database, a table or a relation. So a database consists of multiple tables or multiple relation. So information about an enterprise is broken up into different parts, and each relation will store one part of the database of this information. Example, if you take a bank database, it consists of three relations: account, depositor and customer. Account can be about information about accounts, depositor which customer owns which account, and customer information about customers. So you can have three different parts, and all these three are stored separately as three tables. So transforming that conceptual data model, that is understanding the organization, into a logical data model which is compatible with database technology, that is what is called as logical data database design. And here you are trying to create these table data structures or these all these relations. Our emphasis here is the relational data model. So what we are trying to do is we are trying to create the relations, and the while the ER model, which we will be discussing later, is a conceptual model. The relational data model is the logical model. So we will first go to the logical model, understand what it means, and then go back to the conceptual model of how to get from an enterprise definition into the ER model. So let us go back. We saw three tables like account, depositor and customer. Let us look at how a table looks like or a relation looks like. So this is the account relation. It has got three fields or three attributes. I will tell the name attributes, we will come into the definition of an attribute later: account number, branch name and balance. So this is the account relation. Then you have the depositor relation, the customer name and the account number. Now these two tables or relations have a connection or have a connection between them through the account number. Okay, this, so when you are designing it, you should look at it that way. We will come into this later again when we are talking about that. Then you have the customer relation, where you have the customer name, the customer street and the customer city. Now this is connected to the previous depositor relation through the customer name field. Okay. So you have three different relations: account, depositor and customer. Now the question arises, why can't I store everything in one relation? Why should I split it across three relations as we have done? So storing all information as a single relation, such as bank, account number, balance, customer name, customer address and so on, results first of all in repetition of information. If two customers own an account, what will be repeated? And sometimes a customer can be without an account, he still has not started an account, then the need for null values comes. So these are the two problems in not splitting information. So you should do the correct split. So this is an all the job of the database administrator to actually design the database, the relations of the database appropriately. Next, later on we will be studying about normalization theory and how to design the relational schemas. So the relational database is a collection of normalized relation with distinct relation names. Now a relation. Now let us define what is meant by a relation. Okay. The relational model represents a database and it is a collection of relations or tables, and each relation resembles a simple table. It has a set of rows and a set of columns. So each relation again consists of two parts: a relational schema and a relational instance. Now the instance is the relation having set of specific values for the records in the database at a particular time. So it keeps changing as time changes, values changes, the number of rows it has changes. that so a relation again can be defined mathematically. It is a subset of a Cartesian product of the domains that define R. So, suppose you have attributes a 1 to a n or fields a 1 to a 1, then the domain of a 1 into domain of a 2, Cartesian products of all these together gives the relation. It will be a subset of that. This actually gives the total number of tuples in the Cartesian products, okay, this particular relation, and R represents is represented as R a 1 a 2 to a n. Now, let us look at what are the different components of a relational model, basic relation model. So, the relational model gives us a single way to represent data, and as already mentioned, it is a two dimensional table which is called as a relation. This relation consists of attributes, schemas, tuples, domains, and some equivalent representations of a relation. So, let us go into each one of this in detail. So, first let us look at what is an attribute. So, attributes of a relation serves as names for the columns of the relation, like title, year, length. This is an attribute. Usually an attribute describes the meaning of entries in the column. So, the table here is a relation and the column headers are the attributes. Okay. So, each attribute of a relation has to have a name. Okay. The attributes of a relation are normally unordered. You can have year here, title here, length here, does not matter. But attributes of a relation have an implied ordering. That is, this is the first, this is the second, this is the third. So, but it does not matter actually, because what happens is functions are referenced by name and it is not by position. Now, we will talk about what is the degree. A degree of a relation is the number of attributes it has. For example, this particular relation has a degree of 3 because it has 3 attributes. Okay. Now, let us look at the attribute types. The set of allowed values for each attribute is called the domain of that particular attribute. So, integer means the set of values that is allowed for that particular attribute, which has been defined as an integer, is called as the domain. This is the same domain we have, domain range, when we talk about functions. Attribute values are normally required to be atomic, that is, it has to be indivisible. So, the value of an attribute can be an account number, but it cannot be a set of account numbers. In case your enterprise or your information resource requires that, then there are methods in which you can convert it into atomic attributes. We will see that. So, attribute types, so a domain is said to be atomic if all its members are atomic, and the specific value null is a member of every domain. So, if you take integer domain, null is a member. If you take character domain, it is a member. The null value causes complications, which we will see later. We are not going to discuss it now. Now, the attributes of a relation, as I told you, they can be multi-valued. If it is multi-valued, then you can, one way of defining this is to have a separate relation for that multi-value, or you can represent it through multiple tuples. So, there are two ways in which you get around this problem. If you have multi-valued and not atomic attributes, how to get around that? So, and then the attributes of a relation, if you have optional attributes, that is attributes that necessarily do not have a value for that particular tuple, then you use null values. And it can also be represented by using a separate relation that stores that relation's primary key attributes and the optional attributes. So, that is also possible. So, but basically an attribute in a relation, every attribute, every tuple's attribute has to have a value. So, example of attribute domains, for example, branch number, branch number, set of all possible branch numbers. Here we are defining what its domain is. We are saying it has to be a size of 4 and range has to be like this. Street, street names, and so on. So, you can take, for example, salary, it is monetary 7 digits, and then postcode, character size 8, and so on. So, these are some examples of attributes: branch number, street, city, postcode, sex, sex is only size 1, it has a value only of male or female, and so on. So, this is the format in which you want the dates to be, and so on. So, these are the examples of a attribute. So, we have already discussed the relation database consists of a set of relations, and the relation consists of two parts. The schema specifies the name of the relation plus the name and type of each column. Example here, students has got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 attributes, and you also specify that each attribute, what is the domain. So, here it is string, here it is string, here it is string, here is integer, here is real. So, this is a typical example of a schema of a database. The schema specifies the attributes and the domain of the attribute also. So, the name of a relation and the set of attributes for a relation is called the schema. We show the schema for the relation with the relation name followed by a parenthesized list of its attributes. The relation schema is name, attributes plus other information like keys and other constraints. If you want, the schema can specify what are the primary key and so on and any constraints you want. We will go into detail about this when we are talking about a particular language like SQL. See, the order of attributes is arbitrary. It is not necessary that it should be in a particular order, but in practice we need to assume an order given in the relation schema. That is how you store it. The relational database schema, collection of relation schemas. So, the complete database will have all the relation schemas put together, forms the relational database schema. An example schema is for movies, title, year, length, these are the attributes. Here we have not specified the domain. An instance, now I said that the relational database consists of two parts. One is the relational schema, the second part is the instance. The instance is a table with rows and columns, and the rows, the number of rows of a relation specify it gives its arity or cardinality, and the number of fields or attributes gives us degree, or sometimes that is called as arity. So, you can think of a relation as a set of rows or tuples, and one condition, very important condition, is that all rows have to be distinct. So, a database schema gives a logical view of a database. A database instance is a view of the data in the database at any time. The relation schema corresponds to the type of the type definition. For example, string, movie, Spider-Man, string is the domain and relational instance is the Spider-Man itself. So, a relation schema is formally given domains D1, D2 to Dn, a relation R is a subset of D1 into D2 into Dn and so on. Okay. And the relation can have a set of n tuples A1, A2 to An, and each of this is a tuple, each A1, A2, A3. This AI has to belong to DI. So, a relation schema consists of attribute definitions, name, type, domain, and also the integrity constraint. So, let us look at an relational instance now. Now, here if you look here, the current values or the relation instance of a relation are specified by a table, and an element T, this is T, of this particular table R or relation R is called a tuple. And it is represented by a row in the table or the relation. The order in which this is given, the tuples, is irrelevant, it may be stored in any order. So, as we already saw, this customer is a relation, these are attributes of the relation, and these are tuples of the relation or the rows of the relation. So, this is basically an instance of a relation, and the database instances change continuously, movies can be added, deleted, changed. But mostly the schema is stable, you do not keep changing the attributes, they almost never change, and the relational database instance is a set of tuples that are now in the database. What is now presently in the database is called the instance. When designing the database, only the schema is important, the structure of the database is important, and we only imagine certain instances so that we are sure that the design is correct, help us with the design. So, normally the another terminology used is intentional level is the schema and the extensional level is called as instances, what is currently there. So, now let us look at tuples, we have already seen what tuples are. The rows of a relation other than the header row containing the attribute names are called as tuples, and a tuple has one component for each attribute. So, for example, this tuple has Star Wars for title, 1977 for year, 124 for length. Here we were talking about you cannot afford to have one value as null, I mean you cannot have it empty, you have to put null value. The relation stores sets of tuples and queries actually return bags of tuples, and some of the properties of a tuple are no duplicate tuples are allowed, at least one of the attribute values has to be different. Each tuple of a relation stores a value for each attribute of the relation, this we saw. Every tuple must have attribute values drawn from all the domains of the relation, or you should put null. All tuples stored in the database must be different, that is each tuple has to be unique and it is not ordered, and the cardinality of a relation is the number of tuples that are there. So, we have defined two basic terms, degree of a relation which is the number of attributes, and the cardinality of relation which is the number of tuples that it has. So, So, domain is the set of allowable values for one or more attributes. So, that is the next term. So, we have now spoken about relation, we have spoken about attributes, we have spoken about tuples. Next, we talk about domain. We have already spoken a little about this. Domain is a set of allowable values for one or more attributes. So, it has to be a particular elementary type, for example, integer string like this it can have, and each attribute of a relation associated with the particular elementary type called domain. The components of any tuple of the relation must belong to the domain of the corresponding attribute. So, with title string is associated, with this attribute string is associated, with year attribute integer is associated. So, just to wind up what we were talking about, the basics of a relational model represent data as a two dimensional table which is called as a relation, and these are the attributes of the relation, and this attributes alone becomes a relational schema and its domains, what are the type. These are the tuples of the relation, and schema along with the tuple is called relational instance. The number of attributes is called the degree of the relation, here 4, and the number of tuples is called the cardinality of the relation, here again 4. So, again just to give an example, this is the relation, this is the tuple, these are the attributes, this is the primary key, we will come to that later. The number of attributes gives the degree, number of tuples give the cardinality, and here each of the attributes has a domain associated with it. So, status, name, number, city and so on. Now, let us take an example of a university database. The concept, again to give another example, this is about the supplier, supplier name, supplier status and city. Here again, this is the whole thing is called a relation. The attributes are the supplier number, supplier name, supplier status and supplier city, and the number of attributes is called the degree. These are the number of tuples of the relation. This is at that particular instant, what is the number of tuples? The number of tuples gives the cardinality, and one of these attributes is called the primary key. We will discuss this in detail later, and each of these attributes has got a domain associated with it. Example, the integer, here it could be string, here again it could be integer, and here it could be city, and you can even specify the cities as the domain. Now, let us look at another database, the university database, and let us look at the conceptual schema of this particular database. So, it has got students, which consists of SID, name, login. We have seen this example of this particular relation. It has another relation called courses, which has CID, CNAME and credits, and it has got another relation called enrolled, SID, CID and grade. I will tell you why this is put here later on. Now, how you have this design of the, why have you decided that these are the attributes and these are the relations, that is dependent on how good you are as a database designer. It also depends on the applications or the queries that you want to ask of this database. So, the external schema view course information may be a combination of this. Course information may consist of this CID as well as the enrollment. So, one possible physical schema, now what, how do you store this? Relation can be stored as unordered files, or you can index it on the first column of students, which is the student ID. Basically, the physical is physical data is not stored as unordered files, it is ordered according to the index, because index decides the uniqueness of the tuple. We will come into these in details later, but it is stored in some order of one of the attributes, here may be student ID. Now, this is the example again. So, here you have the database, this is the actual physically where it is stored, this is the conceptual schema, and these are the three views of the particular database. Now, let us look at an instances of the student relation. This can be an instance of the student relation. Do all values in each column of a relation instance have to be unique? So, here if you look, this is not unique, this happens to be unique, this is not unique, this is not unique, but this one of the fields has to be unique. Is cardinality a schema property? It is not a schema property, cardinality is a instance property. Is arity a schema property, arity or degree? That is a schema property. So, this is a diagram for the company relational database schema. The primary keys are underlined Again, we will come into this later on, but here you have employee, lot of details about employee, you have department locations, you have projects, you have works on, and this is dependent. So, if you look here, this is the employee number, which is you are taking as the prime, the uniqueness is specified by the employer key number. The department uniqueness is given by the department number, department location is given by the number as well as the location, which means, see, please note how you must understand the enterprise. This means that there can be a same department in different, same location can have more than one department, same department can be in different locations. This is about the projects. We will come into this example later. This is just to give you a feel of how a database looks like. These are different relations. So, if you look at a comparative terms, in Oracle they use some different terms like relational schema is table description, relation is table, tuple is row, attribute is column and domain is value set. This is self-explanatory, and so these are some terms. So, now let us look at what the relation is. Requirements for a table to qualify as a relation, it must have a unique name. Every attribute value must be atomic, it should not be multi-valued, and every row or every tuple must be unique. That is, you cannot have two rows with exactly the same values for all the attributes. Okay. So, the order of the columns can be irrelevant, the order of the rows also can be relevant. An example relation again, this is that movie schema that we saw, this is an example of that, and this is a course relation example. So, the relations correspond with entity types. And you have many to many relation types. We will come into this in detail again. Rows corresponds to entity instances with many to many relationship instances. Columns corresponds with attributes, again the same meaning of attributes. And the word relation in relational model is not the same as the word relationship in ER model. Relationship is the relation between two entities or two relation entities. So, the relation corresponded to entity. So, there is a slight mismatch between the terminology used. So, you must be clear about that. And this is the relational model. Again, it is based on sets. It is a collection of items of the same type. There is no order, no duplicates. And you can have a one to many relation, many to one, one to one and many to many between two entity sets, which we will come into detail when we are talking about entity sets and ER diagram. This is just to say that it need not be that one entity is related to only one another entity in another relation, it can be, it can have many. Okay. So, this is the summary of what is a relational data model. So, rows are tuples, columns are attributes, relation name per set of attributes is a schema. So, this is the cardinality, this is the arity, just to remind you. So, we have explained the data models and the relational models, described the history of the relational model, discussed various components of relational models, and we have given a large number of examples of what are relations. Now, I want you to explain differences between the terms relation and relation schema. And for the example given in the next slide, I want you to explain all the components of the relational model. You can take an example of a university database, you can take an example of a library database, and you can explain what are the components and probably try to have and design the different relations in an intuitive manner. We will go in detail how formally it is done later on.